We're in the middle of summer. It's a time of relaxation and family and fun and baby blue sports shirts and a time to worship God. Stay tuned for Reach Out and Live. Welcome to Reach Out and Live, a program of music, scriptures, and sermon brought to you each week by the many members and friends of First-Plymouth Church, Lincoln, Nebraska. Hi, my name's Jim, minister at First-Plymouth. It's summertime worship. The congregation is gathered. We have wonderful singer and Justin Payne. Let's worship God together.
You have the scripture before you in your hands, but if I was to tell it, I would tell it like this. Jesus was always eating with the wrong people. In fact, it was almost as if he could enter a room and kind of feel from you who the wrong people were for you, and then turn around and eat with them just to spite you. And so one day he was walking and saw one of these wrong people. His name was Matthew, a tax collector, really a man whose whole life was built around fleecing his fellow countrymen and women so that he would enrich himself. You can imagine if one of your neighbors was doing that to you, he would be a despised one to you. And as if asking this guy of ill repute to follow him wasn't bad enough, then Jesus chose to enter his home and eat, not just in his company, but in the company of other ill repute ones, you know, sinners. Well, the religious leaders of the day, you know, the pastors and bishops and deacons and, you know, the good holy folk got a hold of this and saw it happening, and they murmured to the disciples, "Why is your guy always eating and drinking with the wrong people? Doesn't he know?" Jesus wants nothing to do with his foolishness and reminds them, you know, these folks of ill repute, these sinners, I came for them. These ones that you don't want to eat with. They might not even know it. Matthew might have not even known it, but well, something in his eye told Jesus that this guy was ready for a new life. This guy knew there was something not quite right. Jesus came for mercy. Jesus came not for those who thought they had it all together or didn't need anything. Oh, no. He came for those who knew that they needed healing.
Listen, life is best organized as a series of daring ventures from a stable base. Life is best organized as a series of daring ventures from a stable base. I'm quoting one of the great psychiatrists of the last 50 years, John Bowlby, and he developed attachment theory, the idea that children, ideally, they must attach themselves enough to their parents that they have this stable base from which they can go experiment in life and explore. And they will grow that way if they can take little ventures away from the home, but know they have a stable base. But John Bowlby believes it's the same for adults. You must have some stable base in your life from which you can undertake all the daring adventures. I remember when I first realized the importance of a stable base. I was 19 years old. I was a freshman at Miami University in Oxford, Ohio. And my two roommates were my best friends from high school. And a lot of my high school buddies went to Miami University. So it all felt very familiar. In fact, by the second semester, I started to feel like I was just still in high school. It started to feel constricting. So I called my parents and I said, I'm thinking about dropping out of college, driving to Boulder, Colorado, getting a job, working for a year, and then re-entering college. And both my parents said, they both went, Which is like the perfect reaction from parents, because they're not against it, but it just sort of introduced the chance for them to ask some questions. My mom said, well, why Boulder, Colorado? You've never been there. I said, I don't know, it just sounds cool. She goes, well, I mean, have you considered maybe Seattle or somewhere else? Now she was in on the adventure, but questioning my rationale, which is what moms do very well. And then my dad said, well, how are you going to afford first and last month's rent when you get there? And I said, I've got that. I'm going to stay at the youth hostel for $6 a night, and then I'm going to find a job right away, and then when I get my first check, I'm going to look for an apartment. And then my dad says, you know, if it doesn't work out, you can always come back. Oh, you see, my parents were acting as a stable base. So after the final exams the freshman year, I loaded up everything I owned into my car. Don't you miss when you could put everything you own? I put everything in that car. I drove off to Boulder, Colorado, alone at 19. And as I was coming into town, I'd never been there, the Flatirons started to loom over me. And beyond the foothills, you could see the snow-capped mountains. And it just was magnificent. And it was thrilling to me. And I just could feel the adrenaline rushing. And just as I'm pulling in, I thought, I've got to just drive right into those mountains. And so I went right away up Boulder Canyon, about 5 or 6 miles, and I parked my car. And I started hiking up this steep crevasse, and it was just spectacular.
spectacular, and I couldn't believe that this daring venture was underway. And as I'm hiking up, I'm along this mountain stream, and I put my hand in the cold mountain stream, and I realized my car keys should be in that hand. I had just pulled into Boulder, don't know anyone. I'm now 5 miles out of town, locked out of my car. So I hike back down to the road. I hitchhike back into Boulder. I'm thinking, am I blowing it right away on this daring venture? And I call a locksmith, and I tell him, I don't actually have any money. I've got a $300 check, but he goes, I'll come get you. And so he came in his van, and he drove me up Boulder Canyon, and he got in my car and then fashioned a key. And I said, thank you. And listen, I'm going to give you my wallet. It's got a $300 check in it. Don't cash it, but I'm going to give it to you. You just hold that wallet. I'm going to get a job, and I'm going to pay you. And he goes, no worries, dude. It's on the house. Welcome to Boulder. And I said, dude. He said, dude. And I said, dude. It was so awesome. And then the venture continued, and I ended up living in Boulder for years and re-entering college. And if you have a stable base, you can head out, experience new things in life. Do you have a stable base? Now, to my mind, there are three basic ways an adult can create a stable base so that you can undertake all the adventures. Three basic ways. You could create it in self, or by friends, or by a connection to God. So let me explore these ways. It would be possible to be your own stable base. This wouldn't be easy, but you could create a type of inner resolve, an inner fortitude, where you are your own stable base. In fact, there's an ancient philosophy that's all about that. It was developed by Zeno in 300 BC. Zeno was a Greek philosopher. At the Agora in Athens, he would stand on the porch. The porch was called the Stoa. He would stand out there on the porch, and he began to speak of this philosophy, a way of thinking about the world that created an inner strength. He was teaching on the Stoa, so it began to be called Stoicism, was his philosophy. And a later interpreter, Epictetus, said that there are two basic foundational principles to this philosophy. Number one, you have to rigorously separate what is control, what you can control in life, and what you can't. Oh, you have to think this through very carefully and know the things that you can control and the things that you can't. Because much of unhappiness comes from thinking you can control things that you actually can't. And so these philosophers would work to make sure you separate those into categories. And then they would say, you need to understand you can't control most things in life. That's the far bigger category. You can't control what other people do. You can't control external events. You can't control what's going to happen to your body. Lots of things will just happen. They say true unhappiness is from thinking you can control that. So you have to know you can't. And then the second principle is there is one thing you can always control. Your reaction to what happens. You won't be able to control much of what happens to you in life, but you can control the way you understand it or interpret it, and whether you take a negative approach or if you overreact. And so the Stoics developed this inner strength, knowing I can always control how I react. And they would hold fast to an equipoise, an equanimity. Don't overreact. You could become your own stable base. But it's hard. I don't know about you, but I can't quite pull it off. I'm always anxious, and I'm always reacting to external events and thinking that's either negative or positive, and I'm kind of buffeted around by what happens. It's hard. You could do it. It's not easy. So, I would recommend also looking at other ways for a stable base. And the most important might be friends. You know, the ancient Greeks thought the key to a good life, the very key to a fulfilling, flourishing human life is friends. Oh, and you have to understand what they're saying. A Greek word for love, philia. Philia means the love of friends, and they consider that the primary way we experience love in life, the love of friends, philia. And that's what makes your good life possible. And ideally, if you happen to be married, if your spouse is one of your friends, that's ideal to have that be a friend. And then if you're able to add even just one or two more, I know it's difficult in our disconnected, chaotic world to form friendships. It's not easy. It's hard. But if you can find one or two friends, and if you have enough of that love in your life, that becomes a solid base. It's because of friends you have someone to share your daring ventures with, the adventure of your life. You're not alone in it. And friends always give the best interpretation to your actions. They add a positivity. People that aren't your friends, they'll always wonder about your motivations, and they'll give it a negative cast. Oh, what's he up to? But your friends give the best interpretation. He's trying to lead his best life. He's trying to do good things. And that positivity fuels your adventures. Friends, oh, how much it matters. Even as I'm speaking, I'm hearing that incredible 1968 cover by Joe Cocker of that Beatle classic, "With a Little Help from My Friends." How can I live my life with a little help from my friends? I try when I have a little help from my friends. I can hear it. I can hear it, so you got to hear it. Bring it up. Oh, yeah.
I need someone to love.
You need somebody that loves you. Listen. Yes, you need somebody.
Listen. Oh, I need someone. Oh, just where I'm going, yeah.
Oh, crank it up.
Somebody knows where
yes.
I'm
okay.
Baby.
You can try when you have some friends. Oh, 1968 was a good year. With a little help from your friend. Yeah, you're right. 1968 was a complex year, actually. That song was a great year. Your friends could be a stable base, even if you just have one or two. You can lead your best life. So, do you have a stable base, either in yourself or your friends can create that, but also, maybe most importantly, if you have some connection with God, it becomes the most amazing stable base. Some connection. I don't mean that you have to like believe all the theological doctrines or like just be filled with some deep and ever-present connection with God. If you just even have a little bit of a sense of God, well, then you have this stable base because God's will, ancient theologians were very loath to say we could know God's will, but they would say we can know one thing. God wills your well-being. Oh, we can claim this for sure. God wills that you flourish, that you have fulfillment. This is God's will. And what a stable base it becomes. You now know the essence of reality is hoping the best for you. What a stable base. Any connection to God means you are never alone. If you have any connection to God, you can know that no matter what happens to you in life, in the end, I don't want to spoil the ending, but in the end, it'll be okay. Whatever happens, because there's God. You see, Matthew thought he had a stable base. He did. He's a tax collector. He thinks he's going to create a stable base through money. Now, money can help. I mean, and I wish everybody had tons of money. It's great, but he thinks it's going to be the stable base for him. So as a tax collector, he's collaborating with the Romans. He's preying upon the suffering of his compatriots, because a tax collector tries to collect a little more than he has to pay to Rome, and he keeps that delta, you know. And he thinks that's going to be a stable base, and now he's gone so sideways ethically, he must have been fearful. I mean, like, if you're really afraid and you've got no stable base in life, you become fearful and you can go sideways ethically. And that's what's happened to Matthew, and it's not going to work for him. And then Jesus walks by. And I don't know how this happens, but somehow Matthew is as lost as he is. Somehow he sees in Jesus that divine light. And he follows him. And so now his stable base is going to be his connection to the divine. And that will be the stable base that will allow him to lead his best life, a better life. He was lost. Consider if you have a stable base. And in some way, we're all sitting in the tax booth. I mean, maybe we're constricted or gone a little sideways. We're all sitting in the tax booth, but you always have the opportunity to start following him. I mean, Jesus is always walking by us, and here's what's amazing about Jesus, because he's going to be your stable base. But at the same time, following him is the adventure of life. And so this is amazing. He's both a stable base and he's the adventure. And consider if you have a stable base, because he'll always be walking by. To the glory of God, amen.
I've had many tears and sorrows. I've had questions for tomorrow. There have been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave me blessed consolation, that my trials only come to make me strong. I've seen millions of faces. There were times I felt so all alone. But in my lonely hour, yes, those precious lonely hours, Jesus lets me know that I'm his own. That's why I sing. Trust in God. trust in God. Through it all, I've learned to depend upon His word. I've learned to depend.
I think it's wonderful that we could spend some time in worship together. I hope it's brought you some peace. Do you know you could join our worship services live every Sunday morning on Facebook, YouTube, or our website at 9 or 10:30 or 11:59? And all of that is made possible by gifts from people like you. If you believe that an open-minded, loving congregation can help change the world, then consider making a donation. It will help us increase the love of God and neighbor in both Nebraska and the world. Last year, First Plymouth Church, with your help, bought and forgave over $600,000 of medical debt for struggling families. The FP Just Neighbors initiatives help with the costs of laundry at local laundromats and help fill our neighbors' gas tanks at special volunteer events. And every month, First Plymouth members help feed the neighborhood by acting as a food drop location for the Lincoln Food Bank. There are so many ways you could help us help others. If you would like to join our Sunday live streams or just learn more about our church, go to firstplymouth.org or find us on Facebook and YouTube. As a great theologian said, the glory of God is the human being fully alive. So I hope you feel you have a secure base to begin your adventures to reach out and live.
Tune in again next week for another edition of Reach Out and Live.